This past Wednesday night, I stopped in at the junior youth room, and Kurt had them doing things. They were imitating people that they know or people they see or whatever, and one of them chose me. That was awkward. So this is how he did it. He walked up front, he put his water down, and he goes, "Hey, how are you guys?" You know, and like, so I decided I'll change it up. I walked up this side and put it on. Just try to be different. Try to imitate me next time. How you guys doing? There, I did it again. I got to know how you're doing. I mean, I would never want to start talking to you guys without knowing you're doing good. What a week. It's been a good week. Everybody have a good week? Yeah. Challenging. Some of the areas were challenging, but we learned about grace last week, and so that was a good reminder for me. Some of the people I had to deal with or got to deal with. God's grace extended through forgiveness and love. You guys know we've been talking about Out of the Box, the Out of the Box series, and I've been learning a lot studying about Out of the Box, how to be a church out of the box, what does grace outside of the box look like, and now this week we're going to talk about compassion. What does out of the box compassion look like? What is compassion? Does anybody know the dictionary definition? Any walking brains here this morning? I'll just tell you. Compassion means, it's a noun, it's something that we do, okay? That would be a verb. All right. Sympathetic pity and concern for the sufferings or misfortunes of others. That's a verb, but it does say noun. Sympathetic for the misfortunes of others. Now, we know that when somebody is compassionate about something, there's nothing more interesting or more engaging than when somebody is compassionate about something. It doesn't matter what they're talking about. It doesn't matter what they're doing. If they're compassionate about it, it might not be our cup of tea or in our wheelhouse of things that we like to do, but we can enjoy it because they're compassionate about it. Passion, or compassion, just compassion, is the act of doing something sympathetic, sincerely sympathetic, while people are going through troubles. And that's what we want to talk about this morning. Out of the box compassion. If you have your Bibles or your iPads, your iPhones, however you read the Bible, I want you to turn to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10. And we'll get to it here in a little bit, but just so you can find it. And relax there. So, what do we think about when we think about compassion? And as I was studying, I've had a lot of time to prepare for this. I look for these different areas in life that I can show compassion, or that people have shown compassion to me. There's numerous ways that we can show compassion or have been shown compassion. What is out of the box compassion? And so, I do have some stories that I want to talk to you about. Who comes to our mind when we think in the Bible as we go? We're here at church, so we want to study Scripture. Who do we think of in the Bible? What is the one character that we think of when we think about compassion? Anybody? Jesus. That's right. Jesus. So the Bible tells us many, many stories. And what I think is so interesting, there's a common theme around the act of compassion. When Jesus acts out compassion, there's a common theme that happens. Matthew chapter 9, verse 36. Don't turn to it. I'll just read it to you. It says, "When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless like sheep without a shepherd." Matthew 14:14. Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat, and he had compassion on them and healed their sick. Follow me close. Matthew 15, verse 32. This is now the next chapter. It says, "Then Jesus called his disciples unto him and said, I have compassion on the multitude because they continue with me now 3 days having nothing to eat, and I will not send them away fasting lest they faint in the way." Anybody see a common theme here? There's some things, if you know the context of these scriptures, there's one common theme that's happening in every one of these. When Jesus shows compassion, things change. Things change. Miracles happen. People get fed. People get healed. I got another one. Matthew chapter 20, verse 34. There's where he healed the blind. He says, "So Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes, and immediately the eyes received sight and they followed him. Who wouldn't follow him after you've been blind your whole life and somebody touches you and you can see? Would you not follow that person? That's Jesus. Mark chapter 1, verse 41. Here's where he healed leprosy. Moved with compassion, Jesus reached out, touched him, and said, "I am willing, be healed." The leper had come up to him and said, "Jesus, would you be willing to touch me? And would you be willing to heal me?" And that's when Jesus said, "Yeah." So when Jesus, would we not agree, would we come to a conclusion, that's not all of the scriptures that have the word compassion in it where Jesus was involved, but would you not conclude with me that when Jesus shows compassion, things happen, miracles happen, things change? Luke chapter 10, I want you to turn to Luke chapter 10, verse 25. One day... And I have New Living Translation, so some of you guys will see here a lawyer. In my translation, it says, one day an expert in religious law. So if you have lawyer there, it's not an attorney that they're talking about. It's actually an expert in religious law. One day an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question: "Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life?" You guys got to know who this expert in religious law was. This is a guy who had grown up in the synagogues. He was very well learned in all of the laws and the hundreds of laws and the rituals that the Jewish people had to go through. He knew each and every one of them like the back of his hand. And yet here he comes to test, it says to test Jesus. And he picked the wrong guy to test, because I'm going to go back in Matthew then. This was previously. But Jesus was an absolute master at asking questions, answering questions with questions. When I went through sales training to be a salesman, that's one of the first things that they taught me, because of my personality, because of my behavior patterns, I'm one to what they call show up and throw up. That's not good. You don't spill all your candy in the lobby is another term they use. So in other words, when somebody comes in and asks me about a dining room table, the first thing I'll ask them is, "Where's this going?" And then I just sit back and I let them, "What kind of room is it? How big is it?" One of the first questions I ask now is, "What are the dimensions of the room?" Because one of the biggest weapons that a customer, soon to be customer, will use is say, "Hey, you know what? I'd love to order this today, but we're going to go home and measure." So one of the first questions I address is, "How big is your room?" I ask questions and I learn how to sit back and listen, because as a salesperson, you're supposed to talk 15% of the time and listen 85%. How many of you know that's hard for me? Yeah. I've talked myself right out of sales. Well, Jesus was the best one in the world, as far as if you asked him a question, you can bet your bottom dollar he's coming back with another question. You can read over and over and over in scripture. He didn't answer a lot of the questions that were asked him because he didn't have to. These guys that were out to test him, not just this lawyer, but there was this group of people that would sit in the background and they would follow from a distance and they would sit there and they would criticize each and every move that Jesus made. Everything, every act that he did, they would pick apart theologically and take it back against the law. And the reason they hated him so bad is because the things that he was saying were very unorthodox and were very against their laws and what they had grown up to know. So he asked Jesus this trick question: "How do I inherit? What should I do to inherit eternal life?" And you know what Jesus said? Verse 26, he said, "What does the law of Moses say? How do you read it?" And the man answered, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." There it is. I'm just going to turn back to Matthew chapter 22. And I like to think that this certain lawyer here, this expert of the law that was testing Jesus, might have not been the same one that was in Matthew chapter 22, but he was probably in the same group. So he had heard Jesus say that very same answer previously. So back, if you want to turn to it, you can. Excuse me. Matthew chapter 22, verse 35. Here it is again. This is a different scenario, different day, different time. One of them, and it's previous to the one in Luke. So one of them, an expert in religious law. Here it is again, another lawyer. And I'm not looking down on lawyers. This is not about an attorney. This is just an expert of the law. Says, tried to trap him with this question. In verse 36 says, "Teacher, which is the most important commandment in the law of Moses?" And here Jesus chooses just to go ahead and answer him, and he said like this, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. A second, though, is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself." We've preached this before. In fact, it's what's on our mission statement back there, Matthew chapter 22. "The entire law and the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments." It's a different question, though. It was a different question. He goes, what is the most important commandment in the law of Moses? Okay? And here he asks, what do I have to do to have eternal life? And Jesus asks him the question, what does the law of Moses say? Because you see the correlation between the two. And he answered him himself. And I'll just read it again in verse 27. "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." That's the first and the greatest commandment. And when we live that out, there is nothing left of self. If we live each and every detail of that verse right there, of that commandment that Christ gave, there's nothing left. We give everything to God. I think of the rich young ruler who came to Jesus and asked what he must do to inherit eternal life. And he said, sell all your possessions and follow me. That's a big, big deal for that guy. It would be a big, big deal for us as well. But the second greatest commandment is love your neighbor as yourself. And I think sometimes we overlook that one. And that's the one that we as a church get to show out of the box compassion, is when we love our neighbor as ourselves. I know we talked about last week the grace part, the extension of forgiveness, the extension of love. This time it's compassion. See, this lawyer, this expert of the law, he thinks, he has been trained that he needs to hold up every commandment and every part of the law in order to be saved. Bible tells me that Christ came into the world not to take away the law, but to fulfill the law. There is nothing that we can do on our own to fulfill the law. Christ did that for us. We learned about that last week. So all of the law hangs on those two commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. Everything else revolves around those two. And so we got to get it right. We want to get it right. Verse 29. We're back in Luke chapter 10. Verse 28 says, "Right," Jesus told him, "do this and you will live." In verse 29, the man wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus. See, these guys were following from afar. These guys that were totally nitpicking and pulling Jesus apart from everything that he was doing. Here Jesus had answered the question that was asked. He asked the lawyer back the question, right? And so what does the lawyer do? He says, "You know what? I don't like being belittled in front of my friends. You made me look small because you just told us what you had told us previously, whether it was a month or 2 months or 6 months, it doesn't matter. He had said it previously, and I had to answer my own question. So I'm going to ask you another one." And he said it like this, "Who is my neighbor? You say that. All right. If that's how I inherit eternal life, well, now who's my neighbor?" In Dutch, we would say, "Ich bin Lieblingsweg," right? It was one of those guys. We all know people like that. We have people in our lives that are like that. They just want to asked you another question, right? They're not quite satisfied. And Jesus seen, you know what? I'm going to have to paint a pretty good picture for these guys, or they're just not going to get it. Who is our neighbor? In the lawyer's circumstance, or in his world, was it the scribes? Was it the Pharisees? Was it the people that lived next to him? Was it the Gentiles? Was it the Romans? Surely not. Those were enemies. And so Jesus said it like this, and we're going to read it now from verse 30 all the way down to 37. You guys ready? Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along, but when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant walked over and looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. Verse 33, then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey, took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here. Now, which of these 3 would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by the bandits? Jesus asked. And the man replied, the one who showed him mercy. Then Jesus said, yes. Now go and do the same. Let's talk about that journey between Jerusalem and Jericho. If you look at it today, the way a crow flies it direct from point A to point B, from Jerusalem to Jericho, it's about 16 miles. Now, there was no buses, there was no cars, there was nothing like that to take you there. I believe most likely this man was on foot. I don't think he was riding a donkey, but I think he was probably on foot. I'm using my imagination here. If I see somebody on foot just walking, if he doesn't have any type of representation of wealth, and I'm not a thief, so I'm never thinking of like taking something from somebody, but obviously he may have had an ox in a wagon or some type of belongings that he was walking along beside on this 16-mile trek between Jerusalem and Jericho. Something about him was appealing to the robbers who had laid beside the road or hidden beside the road waiting for someone to come by. And I don't think they just robbed everybody that came through. I think they were pretty strategic. Would you not agree? I mean, I don't get robbed. I better not say that. Wow. I haven't gotten robbed. How about that? But I think this guy might have shown a little bit of wealth, it doesn't say, but he had something of value that these guys wanted. And so they robbed him. They stripped him, they beat him, and they left him for dead. They left him half dead, laying beside the road. I think it's interesting as I study where Jerusalem is and what Jerusalem is about. It's the city of David. It's the city of David. It's been fought over for centuries by all kinds of different religions trying to take hold and be the dominant religion. Honestly, there are people that say it's the most pivotal city in the history of humanity, Jerusalem. John writes about it in Revelation, the New Jerusalem. It's the holy city. It's represented as a holy city. And so if it's representing as a holy city, it might represent the holiness that we are created in. We're created in God's image, which is holy. Would you not agree? And so this man was leaving the holy city, so to speak, and he was headed to Jericho. Well, what was Jericho? It was the land of Canaanites. They had spent a lot of years defying God and running from God. In fact, they say it was one of the tightest cities that there ever was. There was no one going in, no one going out. The government had shut it down. They had built the walls. Remember the big, big walls that came down? That was Jericho. Joshua was one of the first battles that Israel had as they came through, as Israelites had as they came through the Promised Land, was the walls of Jericho. So here was this fallen city, this city, Jericho, and here was this holy city, Jerusalem. And I'm just using my imagination now. But when we were formed in our mother's womb, that was a holy, holy thing, right? That's God's, we were formed as holy. We were born into sin, okay? So the road to Jericho is filled with a lot of sin. And I look at the robbers that robbed this man that was walking along this road. I feel like that was sin. If you can use the analogy of sin, stripped him, beat him, and left him for dead. How many of us have been walking down that road of life where we get beat, we get stripped of everything we have, and we're left for dead? We leave the holiness of God's creation, born into a broken world. Oh, I get that. That was me. We're all born that way. And because of sin, we're separated from the holiness of God. And so we're looking for someone to help us. And some of us are still laying beside the road, half dead. Everybody's on this same journey. Some of us are farther ahead. Some of us are farther behind. Some of us are still laying there, stripped of everything, beat down, half naked, and half dead. What's interesting is in verse 31 is, by chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A priest, a man of cloth, clergy, preacher. A guy who gets to minister God's law. Back in that day, that's what he did. He spoke God's law. He kept that God's law. There were priests that would be in the temple. They were supposed to, part of their job was to have sacrifice, make sacrifice for the tribe's sins, for everybody's sins. Before Christ, we were not worthy of making our own sacrifice. But the priests were. So they were up there in the scale of leadership at the church or at the temple. It would be like me walking down 39 and seeing somebody laying beside the road and like, oh, I'm dressed. I'm dressed like this. I'm going to preach this morning. I better not. It looks like I might get bloody or dirty or it's not quite what I want to do. That's what happened. A priest walked by, didn't want to help. He walked to the other side of the road. Have we ever walked to the other side of the road? Your minds, as you're thinking, I've got a couple examples. I had two different conversations this week, and I won't tell you who. You probably wouldn't know. I had two different conversations. There's an individual that I know well who has been divorced for 13 years. And I asked someone that knows him duly well. I said, do you think they'll ever get back together? Without hesitation, no. No. Why would you say that? I said, because I do. I know we deal with people with addictions. We deal with people that go through marriage problems. We deal with that type of thing. And sometimes, as bad as it gets, I know sometimes it's hard to say, yeah, I believe that God can heal that, or I believe that God will take care of that, or I believe that God will restore. How many believe that God is a God of restoration? Raise your hands. How many believe that God is a God of completeness and wholeness? Raise your hands. So why in the world would we ever say, I know we live in a broken world, and the one conversation led to the next, and we kind of got into it, and I said, why would you not believe with me that they're going to get back together? And it came back, well, we live in a broken world. Some things aren't meant to be fixed. These are Christian people. That's not compassion. In my book, I tell you what, as long as we have breath and as long as we have life and as long as that's hope, That's hope for restoration. And if we don't, as a Christian people, if we don't believe that God can do it, who's going to? Who's going to believe for them? I know it's bad time. I know they go through tough times. I know there's brokenness. But if we don't believe it, who's going to? And so I asked this person, I said, so you don't believe that? And he goes, do you? What do you think I said? Yes, I believe it. Absolutely. And I'll tell you right now, and I hate to expose it this way, but if God can heal Becky and I's situation, he can heal anybody's. She hates when I use the word hate, but we hated each other. She dislikes when I use the word hate. Did I say hate? I said it a couple times. But you guys know, God can heal any situation. It's whether we as a church, I believe so much that we stand in the gap for these poor people who can't believe for themselves. We are called as Christian people, if we have faith, we have no right in saying, you know what, that's a bad situation. I don't think it'll ever work out. Or, you know what, he's drinking so much. I just had Friday night, I had a guy come to me, tell me that one of my lifelong buddies, and I'm going to ask you guys to hold me accountable to this, okay? One of my good friends said, have you seen him lately? I said, no. He said, he looks horrible. I said, what's going on? He said, he's drinking himself to death. He's going to die if somebody doesn't help him. I said, why doesn't somebody help him? He said, we've tried. Nobody can seem to help him. Would you go? And I said, I will. I said, will you go with me? Yeah, but I can't next week and I can't the week after. It'd be 3 weeks from now before I go. I said, just give me his number. I'll go. We don't have time. We don't want to get involved. It's too messy. So hold me accountable. Somebody asked me if I went to see him this week, because that's my plan. I'm going to see him this week. He's not doing well. He's depressed. He says he's going to fill his tank with gas and drive till it's empty and shoot himself when the car runs out of gas. So he's not in our area. That's going on around us. These are people we know. These are people we love, and yet we don't have time. It's just a simple thing of compassion. Here was this priest who was a preacher of all people, didn't have time. He walked to the other side of the road because he didn't want to get involved. Verse 32. My Bible says a temple assistant. Your Bible probably says a Levite. If you don't know what a Levite is, I'll tell you in a minute. A Levite walked over, looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. This guy now, this is a Levite who is a temple assistant, so to speak. He is the priest's assistant. He does basically the groundwork, the legwork. He helps the widows out. He helps the orphans out. He goes out and he takes meals to people. He does all this kind of thing. He prepares the lambs. He gets them ready for the sacrifice. He kind of does the legwork, the grunt work, so to speak, for the priests. And I don't know which way he was going. He might have been going from Jericho to Jerusalem, Jerusalem to Jericho. Doesn't matter. I don't know which way he was headed. Doesn't say. But he actually had a little more compassion than the priest did. He actually walked over and looked at him. And there's where he made his decision that he doesn't want to help. It says he walked over to the other side and walked on. This Levite might have been going to Jerusalem to become a pastor or to become a priest. And it's like, you know what? I get my license next week, and if I stop and help this guy, it's going to delay me. I just don't want to get involved. It looks just a little too dirty. It looks a little bit too bad. He looks a little too far gone. It's going to take a little bit too much time. Now imagine us seeing a guy laying down here beside 39, and we just wouldn't help him. Imagine that. The Bible says that faith without works is dead. I know, but this guy wasn't willing to pick up his finger to do anything. We're not saved by the good things we do. We're only saved by the belief in Jesus Christ. I think what's interesting is, as I studied this, I've seen the overflow of joy from our salvation, from the belief in Jesus. If we know that we're saved, that and we believe in salvation, the overflow of that is what will dictate our actions. So the priest and the Levite, it also, the overflow, what, there was none there, and it also dictated their actions. This guy's laying there. He cannot help himself. He can't crawl. He can't scratch his way to help. He needs somebody to help him. And we pass these people. We brush shoulders with these people each and every day on this journey from Jerusalem to Jericho, on this journey for life. We have many, many, many opportunities to help. Here's verse 33. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Who was this Samaritan? The Samaritan was like, who's it? Kind of the scum of the earth. They were despised by the Jews. They were looked down upon. They weren't quite to the status that they needed to be. It was a line that could not be crossed or shouldn't be crossed. In fact, if you go back to John where Jesus was at the well with the Samaritan woman, they looked and they said, "Why are you with that Samaritan woman?" Remember that? This was the same breed of people. Most unlikely source came along. And in verse 34 it says, going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. He's traveling along that same road. And it, again, the Samaritan, it doesn't say which way he was going. But he had the resources there to help. He didn't have much, but he had a donkey. And he had olive oil and wine. And he had something to wrap his bandage with. He didn't have much. But what he had, he was willing to give, and he was willing to take care of this guy. The Samaritan had compassion. That's something that the priest and the Levite lacked. So real quick here, I want to tell you what I think, who I think is the Samaritan in the story. I believe that the Samaritan in the story is Jesus. If you look at it, we, the people laying beside the road, every one of us sometime in our life, we're laying beside that road on the journey between Jerusalem and Jericho. We're on the journey of life. Sin has beat us down at some time or another. It doesn't matter who we are. It has beat us down, stripped us down, and left us for half dead. We are those people. I believe that the guy laying there represents us. Jesus, the Samaritan, represents Jesus. And Jesus comes and binds up the wounds of the brokenhearted. He picks us up, puts us on his back, and carries us to an inn. Now, what do you think the inn represents? Anybody have an idea? Right here, the church. And this is where we as a church have the opportunity to care for people, because we are the body of Christ. And when Christ starts healing these people, and they get to Christ, they come in here, they need help. We are going to be some of these people's only help. You need to always care for those who are stripped down, beaten, and left for dead. We shouldn't be a source of condemnation or judgment. These people that are out there laying along the streets have all heard about the church, and they all have, not all of them, but some of them have actual bad reputation, thoughts of what the church looks like, because all they do there is condemn people. All they do there is judge people. And I'm telling you guys, here at Light in the Valley, I don't feel that. I don't feel we're that way. But I just want to, it's a good reminder of us to never default to that. Because if we don't watch ourselves, we can soon default to judgment and condemnation. And that's not what was going on at the inn. We are some people's only source of care and comfort. We're some people's only source of out-of-the-box compassion. Christ puts oil and wine in the wounds. He binds them up, puts them on his back, brings them to us. What will we do with this mandate? The mandate that is from God and from Jesus himself. We care for them as he cared for us. We raise them up as he was raised up. We love them as he loved them. And we teach them as he taught us. That's our job as Christians. That's our job for compassion. Verse 35 says like this: the next day he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here. The Samaritan gave all he had. Christ gave his life for us. Can you see it? He gave everything he had. There's nothing that we can do to pay that debt. Nothing. Jesus paid everything. Verse 36. Now, which of these 3 would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by the bandits? Jesus asked. And I ask you, who helped you? I know right now you're thinking of that one person that was so highly influential in your life. I know I do. I remember so well the guy that led me to the Lord. The guy that led me to the Lord was a guy that took me hunting from 12 years on. He took me under his arm because my dad wasn't a big hunter and he knew I liked to hunt. And so he would take me hunting. Every season he would call me, hey, Jimmy, I'm gonna have a place for you to hunt. And it was out of that compassion and out of that love when I remember so well one night. I was 18 years old and I thought, man, you know what? If I die tonight, I'm not going to make it to heaven. And I want to make it to heaven. And so I called him up. He was the only guy I knew to call. He was the only guy that I was really comfortable in calling because he had shown me love and compassion just through a simple hunting. Just through hunting. Who's helped you? Who have you helped with out-of-the-box compassion? Here's the verse. The last verse, verse 37. The man replied, the one who showed him mercy, and Jesus said, yeah. Now go and do the same. You guys stand. Out of the box compassion looks like this. We must love our neighbors as ourselves. That's the second greatest commandment. First of all, we love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then we love our neighbor as ourselves. And you say, well, what can I do? I have no idea. For one guy, it was taking me hunting. Who'd have thought? I don't know what God's telling you to do, but I do know this. There are people in your lives that you can influence and that you can show compassion to that will forever change who they are, maybe who you are in the future. It waits in the balance. It hangs in the balance for you to show compassion. All I can say is this, whenever you do it, whatever God is asking you to do, keep Jesus in the center of it. Keep Jesus in the center of everything that he's asking you to do. And the first foremost thing for compassion that's out of the box is we as Christians. We've got to stop looking the other way. We got to stop going on the other side of the road. We have to take the time not only to walk over and look, but to actually do something. Do something with the resources you have. It might be oil and wine and a donkey, but you can make a difference. God's calling us to be compassionate. Let's pray.